Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. My name is David Sembeck. I'm the head of the Policy and Analysis Division at APO. Today, I invited the CEO of Unicorn Startup in Indonesia, Bukalapak, the Mr. Rachmat. So, Mr. Rachmat, thank you very much for joining us today. Let me just introduce Mr. Rachmat a little bit before we start. So Mr. Rachmat Kaimuddin is a seasoned leader with a cross-field and industry background, including experience in engineering and financial management. He was awarded a Bachelor of Science from MIT, Cambridge, and MBA from Stanford University, California, United States. And prior to joining Bukalapak, he served as a director for finance and planning for PT Bank Bukopin, TBK, starting in 2018, and as a member of the board of a commissioner for the same bank up until his appointment as director in 2014. So Mr. Rachmat started his career as a senior associate at the Boston Consulting Group and some other experiences, including managing director of PT Kartik Air Services and CFO of PT Bosowa Corpor Indo, managing director of PT Semen Bosowa Maros, vice president of Marine Private Equity Asia, and principal of. So, Mr. Rachmat, again, thank you very much for joining us today. So if we are ready, you can start your own presentation.
Yeah, thank you, David. And hi, everyone. It's an honor for me to share our story here in Bukalapak. So as David said, very kind introduction, Bukalapak is one of the startup companies in Indonesia, technology in e-commerce. And we have started since 2010. And a few years ago, we have reached the unicorn status, which is a big honor and also, kind of like spirit and a burden for us also to keep improving. So today I'm gonna quickly share a story of like what are the problems that we want to solve and how we are trying to solve it using basically our product or our technology. So one of the key things that we've seen in Indonesia is basically a lot of disconnectedness. And it created a few things. First is an economic gap. Yeah, there are big businesses in Indonesia, like many Asian countries, but a big percentage of the economy is driven by small and medium enterprises, which has relatively, lack of capital, and the amount of transactions actually in terms of value is probably not that big. But it's also very important for the economy and also very important as absorption of labor. So, there is a big gap there. The second one is in infrastructure. Indonesia is basically comprised of 17,500 islands across three time zones. And we have about, maybe 270 million people. And that is... and unfortunately, the infrastructure that people enjoy is not equal. There are a few islands that is relatively more developed. Maybe about 60% of our population live in Java, and Java is relatively small, but it's probably the most densely populated island in the world, and it has relatively decent infrastructure. But if you go to the other islands, like Sumatra is probably even is better, but Kalimantan, East Indonesia, like Sulawesi and whatnot, we start seeing big gap in terms of infrastructure. And then another problem that we've seen is financial inclusion. A lot of people are still using cash as a payment system. It's not yet connected to the banking system, and as a result, it creates a lot of difficulties for them to basically, you know, do transactions, also get access to basic financial services. And these are the kind of things that I think maybe, you know, become a barrier for Indonesia, despite like all the great work that has been done by the government. We see that as a barrier for us to jump from the typical, you know, 6% economic growth in Indonesia. And then Indonesia is also quite well known to be technology savvy, or like, you know, connected to the internet in the world. It's that we've seen in the statistics that the internet users in Indonesia has grown quite significantly from 92 million in 2015 to become, you know, 152 million in 2019. And maybe now it's about 170 million. And this is a pretty big number in terms of people who use internet. And there's a big potential there. But when we see the other statistics, especially in the economic sector, it's the number is less rosy. In terms of e-commerce to retail transaction, before COVID, it's actually hovering around middle single digit, like 4-5%. And our thoughts is that basically, you know, connected to the gaps that we discussed before, about 66% of people are without bank accounts. And even the business who are actually, you know, operating in Indonesia, they are less technologically savvy. And maybe about 1/6 of them adopted technology. So a lot of the people here, you know, sometimes when we see all these gaps and we want to connect them with the technology, we have the internet, but the fact of the matter is there is still a lot of homework for us. And the number shows that, and like all those problems are because of financial inclusion and also because of people who are probably reluctant to trade using technology, basically as a seller as well as a buyer. And this is kind of like a paradox that we want to help resolve. When we take a look at closer in terms of commerce, yeah, basically there are maybe we can divide it into a few things. One is the platform itself. The platform should have basically a place whereby people can do trading, which is with clear rules, and the platform is also has to be reputable, has to be trustworthy, and that platform has to have a lot of sellers. Basically, full the merchandise selection has to be complete, because otherwise people will not be able to find the goods that they're looking for. And then this platform is also has to be visited by a lot of buyers. And then, like any other problems in commerce, if you want to do buy and sell, you need to think about also the problems of sending the goods or logistical problems, and also the way to pay it. Because even though if you want to buy it, but you know, if you're not connected to means of payment, then there is no transactions. So these are the kind of things that we want to solve, because we want to push commerce into more people in Indonesia. So have complete merchandise, have good buyer traffic. We need to ensure logistics are reliable, multiple payment methods that can be accepted by people. And then the platform has to be fair and has to be trustworthy. Has to have a clear rule that people easy enough to understand, and people can say like, okay, you know, if I do it, this is how to do it when we do the trading. So again, in Bukalapak, what we are trying to do is to be a marketplace. And the things that we are working on, first is that we focus on small and medium enterprises and what we call middle to low segment. I think like in Indonesia, there are few big cities and there's also big companies, and these guys are basically benefiting from the infrastructure and the economic growth in Indonesia. For us, what we want to do, the reason why we are focusing on this is that because we think that they are relatively unserved or underserved, and we actually want to focus on this segment. So we want to serve the underserved. And in order for that, in order to do that, we understand that we have to have a lot of operational capabilities, because when we start dealing with a lot of transactions, you need to deal with a lot of people, then you have to have a lot of ability to deal with many segments, many type of transactions, and you have to do it also efficiently. I've also discussed a lot about Indonesian geographical challenge and logistical challenge. You know, if you want to serve the underserved, you also have to have extensive coverage across Indonesia, because like Indonesia has a very interesting shape. Landmass is disconnected by the ocean, even though a lot of people live in Java, but like, you know, hundreds of million people also live across the 17,000 islands, and they all want to transact as well. What we also have been doing is that we understand that we cannot do this alone, and like many Asian countries and also many developing countries, government and state-owned enterprises is also pretty critical in the economy. So we need to be able to work with them and basically cooperate in order for us to develop this service. And we are quite proud to say that we do this in terms of like in the private sector manner, but through communication and also delivering value to the society. We are kind of like, you know, recognized from time to time, like, you know, there's a new initiative that the government want to do, or the state-owned enterprise want to ask to help. Typically, we are one of the few names, first names to be called and discuss or work together. And Bukalapak is an Indonesian company started by my predecessor. So this is also one of our core identity, being Indonesian. And how do we solve some of these problems in terms of platform, sellers, logistics, and whatnot? Like through the operational capabilities, at the moment, we try to serve our customers using two products, two applications, if you will. And we think of this as a two-in-one platform, and they're kind of connected. The first one is through online marketplace. The online marketplace is where we started. We opened it in 2010 through like in a website first, and then we create the application. So this Bukalapak application right now is home for maybe about 6 million merchants or people who actually put up something to sell. And right now we have about actually maybe more than 100 million online users today. And of these merchants, they have uploaded about 400 million SKUs, and basically to help people to do transactions, we partner with 12 logistic partners, all 3PLs, and we also have 26 bank or payment partners. And we are hoping with all this, you know, we can enable people who are already basically online savvy, they have bank accounts or digital currency, then they can do transactions in e-commerce using Bukalapak. The other product that we have is what we call Mitra Bukalapak, or basically Bukalapak partners. And this is a product that we launched in 2017, so more than 3 years ago. And what it is basically, it's a seller application. So this is an application that is downloaded by the mom and pop kiosks or the offline agents. And what this application will enable them to do is basically this application will enable them to do two things mainly. The first one is for them to order goods, like physical goods. We actually provide, we are working with a lot of principals and wholesalers and distributors in the back so that this mom and pop kiosk can order using their application. They can order their FMCGs. And the beauty of it is that typically, you know, this mom and pop kiosk, if they want to buy goods, they are typically owner operator. They want to buy something, they will need to close down their shop and they go out and go to the market and buy to restock. Using Mitra Bukalapak, they don't need to do that anymore. They can just basically, you know, in the application order, and then within a certain period, then we will deliver. We will deliver the goods. The second part of the of the capabilities of this Mitra Bukalapak is what we call virtual products. So in the online application that we have, we also work with a lot of merchants or service providers that wants payment. So you think about it as your electricity payments or phone credits or like, you know, paying tickets or your like whatever, like, you know, buying tickets and whatnot, whatever vouchers or virtual products that you sell, typically we put it in our application. And then we put that capability into the mom and pop kiosk as well through this application. So the idea is that this warung can provide the similar service as the modern trade, like, you know, the branded small grocery shops as well, or kiosk. And this capability suddenly will enable everyone who actually doesn't have digital currency and who are actually not comfortable using doing transaction online. This Mitra Bukalapak will provide this this bridge so that people, like, you know, regular people who doesn't want to trade online or transact online, they can now be connected to the e-commerce world despite the disconnectedness before, because now they can just go to their closest mom and pop kiosk, which is their neighbor, and they can do all these transactions that they probably wouldn't be able to do before, or they are not comfortable doing before, or maybe they have to go travel a few kilometers from their home to do. And with this, suddenly we open up all this network or commerce into practically everyone in Indonesia. So basically, on the marketplace, this is a few examples. On the physical products, we have two types of service. Basically, one is from the small and medium enterprises, or C2C. So this is like basically anyone who want to do trading can open their shop, basically install Bukalapak, apply to be a merchant, and then they can start trading. In order also to help people who are looking for more branded goods, or you know, big brands also have kind of like a separate service, but in the same application, we call it Buka Mall. This is a B2C service as well. I discussed a lot about before on the virtual products. So there's a payment system, electricity, credit card bills, social security, top up of phone credit, electricity, travel. And then there's another few things that this can do. One is financial services. So people who can apply for loans in our application. It started with our merchants because we kind of know their transactions, and they typically need working capital as well. We provide that with help, as well as our buyers. They can also apply, and you know, they can ask for car loans or even like home loans. We partner with some banks to provide this. Once you also create a lot of transactions, it's only important for the people to be able to do some financial planning as well. So in Bukalapak, we have some investment products. People can buy what we call Buka Reksa. Reksadana is basically a mutual fund. So we are an agent of mutual fund. So we work with a lot of investment managers, like very reputable investment managers in Indonesia. And then people can buy mutual funds with a very small amount, I think starting from 1,000 rupiah at the moment. And if people like to buy gold, they can also buy gold in a very small fraction. We work with a few companies who act as a custodian, and then once they reach certain grammage, they can ask for the physical gold. So this is the kind of things that we want people to be able to transact in the virtual products. Just quickly discuss about the Mitra Bukalapak or the seller apps. At the moment, we have about 5.4 million offline presence, which is mom and pop kiosk as well as the offline agents, and about 4.5 million of them are in Java, which is kind of typical because this is our biggest population, most populated island, and more a lot more infrastructure. But even then, we also have in many other places, like in Sumatra, half a million warung and agents, and Kalimantan and East Indonesia, a few hundred thousand as well. And more, we would like to increase coverage because we want more and more people is connected to the e-commerce. Again, the idea of the Mitra Bukalapak is to digitize the Indonesian people, both the merchants as well as the people who are actually still comfortable trading or buying their stuff from the warung. And warung is a very important part of the fabric of the society because they are typically a member. They are like one of the neighbors and kind of they know everyone, and you know, these guys are trustworthy agents. And if we are not helping them to also connected and also helping them to adopt technology, they could be fallen behind. I'm just gonna skip this, which I explained just now, but basically what we want to do is to provide the SMEs, the Mitra Bukalapak, with kind of organization purchasing power and technology so that they can be kind of sitting in the same height, or like, you know, being in the same playing field with the modern trade. And hopefully with that, then they can add more goods to trade or more SKU. They have more income and better margins. This one I'll skip. And yeah, I think basically for us in Bukalapak, a lot of people sometimes see us as, big organization, technology, very cool. But basically what we are and what keeps us going is we really want to see our customers are successful. The online merchants will be able to make more trades. The Mitra will be able to have more margin, more goods, both physical as well as virtual, and they make more living for themselves and the family, and as well as for our users, our buyers. They can do their transactions easier. They can find goods simpler, and also hopefully with the kind of competition and whatnot, you know, with better value as well. So that is probably my, you know, my explanation on Bukalapak quickly. And thank you again. And I'll give it to David for Q&A. Thank you, David.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. Let me just play the video for Bukalapak. Okay, so let's get to the discussion. So thank you very much for the insightful presentation again. I just start with the value proposition of Bukalapak. I know that you already walk us through that why Bukalapak is there, but if you can just summarize it.
Sure. Basically for us, what we want to do is to kind of provide what we call, our mission statement, we call it a fair economy for all. Which basically what we meant by that is you want to bring an ability for people to do, you know, to trade or to do buy and sell goods and services fairly and, you know, for everyone. And the way we want to do it is basically to, you know, by creating, solving, we call it information problems, solving logistical problems, solving payment problems, and also basically solve the trust issues in doing the transaction.
Okay, thank you. That actually leads me to another question, because I know that you have a good intention only, but then you know, sometimes e-commerce is known to have disseminated small businesses and also help them find new markets. So it's like sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. I mean, everything has a pros and cons. But then many small businesses sell their products through Bukalapak now, which it seems beneficial. But in your opinion, is e-commerce hurting them or not?
Yeah. So basically from the beginning, what we envision is that we want to create a better economic ecosystem for these small offline players. And the basic thought is that you know, if you look at in the physical world before e-commerce, you know, you have this, let's say, small offline players or small merchants. They typically cannot compete with these big corporations. You know, the big corporations will have more capital, and with more capital, they have, you know, more goods, more employees, shops that is better located, more convenient, shinier and whatnot, right? And basically, that is something that we think this discrepancy is much less in the technology. Basically, when once you start using it in the internet, you start selling in the internet, that barrier is actually flattens. It's not practically, it's not that much difference between shops of even the small players can make very nice shops with relatively little capital, if you will. So I, of course our hope is that we try to do no harm, or right? Try not to hurt small offline players, and basically again what we want to do is we'll always try to provide more chance for them. Again, for example, when we created this O2O business or Mitra Bukalapak, the goal is to go to this small offline players or the mom and pop kiosk, and we give them with technology so they can order something, hopefully with a better price and basically more services that they wouldn't have been able to get, they won't be able to go directly to this big corporation to sell electricity or to sell pay tickets and whatnot, and using that we give it to them. So yeah, I mean that is our thoughts and our hope, and of course the people who are currently maybe feel threatened by this offline the e-commerce or online, we are welcome. We try to welcome them, and we try to also help them so that they can be onboarded into the ecosystem. Basically, especially during this COVID time, where a lot of transactions shifted from offline to online, we provide a regular onboarding program so people can just join us in some of these webinars, and they will be educated on how can they continue their business and how can they create a new channel for the business. So that is our hope, David.
Okay, thank you. So at the moment, Bukalapak advertises its success in organizing communities, but why are communities needed for buying and selling own website? And then could you explain this and your vision of web retail communities? I remember that when I was visiting the Bukalapak in 2018, I remember that they promote and the importance of the communities, and they are actually kind of talking about very proudly that Bukalapak has organized really good communities.
Yeah. So, I mean, I believe that is something, that is unique, and it's quite maybe interesting to tell the story. Basically, as we discussed, Bukalapak is not a merchant. We are a marketplace, right? So we are providing a platform whereby people can buy and sell. And we are focusing on small and medium enterprises. And you, as you can probably guess, yeah, in Indonesia, dealing with small and medium enterprises using technology, there is a big lack of sophistication on using this platform. And of course, we cannot do this alone. So what we start doing is we created communities, start from small, and then it becomes something that we do a lot, and now it's in more than 100 cities or areas, and then this is a group of people whom they are kind of self-sustained, and they start like exchanging ideas, they start from learning, because they start learning from each other, and I think this is great for us, because you start seeing like people who are very knowledgeable because they've been with us for a long time. They know how to best use our platform, they meet new friends and in there's a new guys who don't know what they're doing first, and you know, they get educated, they met new friends, they met new family. I've seen some people who are actually get married between the members of the community. And us as Bukalapak, we try to encourage them, and you know, these guys are our maybe our first of all big family member. I would like to say promoter, but it's also very good, you know, good resources to keep us honest, because you know, because they are part of the family. If we don't do something very well, we'll hear it directly from them, and they're quite happy to give us their peace of their mind as well. So I mean, yeah, this is why I know it's very interesting dynamics with us. But this is something that started with Bukalapak, and we believe it's an integral part of Bukalapak.
Okay, thank you. So now, who are your business partners? So how they work with Bukalapak? And how do you create the synergy with them?
Yeah, if you talk about our kind of our main business partners, basically the ones that comes to mind is our online merchants and the warungs. These are without them, there is no Bukalapak basically. But these guys are. You know, scattered, there are millions of them, and they're trading maybe relatively in small numbers. But in the corporate side, if you will, our main strategic partners, of course, is the ones that will enable us to do this operation, the logistic partners. Right now we are dealing with about 12 3PLs, and we actually try to, you know, we don't have our own logistics 3PLs. What we do is we work with these guys, and because we believe like by working with a lot of people, hopefully people will get a choice, and then you know, we'll be able to increase the service to our customers. The other one will be the banks or the e-wallet, basically the ones that will enable all the type of payments as well. You know, without being able to pay, these are very critical. And then, well, you know, we have many other people like our technology provider, you know, the ones that give us with the server and all that kind of stuff, the cloud. So yeah, I mean, we are here just a group of people trying to build a technology, but we can only do it with the help of a lot of our partners.
Okay, thank you very much. So let me go to another question. So during the COVID-19 pandemic, your sales revenue have been higher than ever. So this is a hard time for everyone, but what types of new business opportunities do you see in the short and medium terms?
Yeah, I think basically this COVID-19 for the most part is something that is very challenging for everyone, right? Because it shifted some behaviors. People are, first, they are a little bit more considerate if they want to go out, and then so they stay at home more, and it comes with certain types of change of behavior as well. They also being bombarded with a lot of news about the COVID, and you know they are started to be more health conscious as well. And they also have more time to kind of take a look at themselves, take care of themselves as well. And because of this pandemic, it comes with some economic impact as well. And those impacts affects if not themselves, they can affect their relatives, their friends. We see a lot of people who get, you know, whose livelihood is being impacted. So basically, some of these trends create certain type of behavior, and every change of behavior will create business opportunities. So I would say, you know, people probably in general, they try to be a little bit more frugal, and they try to be more health conscious, and they probably stay at home more. So the maybe the short to medium terms, and I believe this could be something that relatively permanent. Yeah, the things that is related to those type of things, the business opportunities is how can we make people what are the things that people need if they stay at home more to make their life more comfortable. So maybe going out clothes is relatively less, but nice pajamas or like, you know, bed sheets or whatever, or, you know, toys, hobbies in at home is something that people need now. Anything related to health, for example, we see a lot of demands for bikes in Indonesia, because people probably want to, you know, they want to ride bikes. They don't want to take a taxi. So they was like, okay, maybe you know, riding bikes is something I want to do now. We've seen a lot of increase right now on that. And, you know, the disposable income drops makes some of the expensive goods are decreasing. But, you know, in the end of the day, people still need to buy stuff. You know? So maybe a lot of value for money merchandise. For example, myself, yeah. During this COVID, I started losing weight for some reason, because maybe I don't go out more. So I eat more at home and I lose a lot of weight, and I need to buy new clothes. And I found in Bukalapak, there is a lot of Indonesian providers that sell less branded goods. And when I bought them, you know, it's pretty good. The quality is actually very competitive, and the price is just a fraction of some of these typically branded goods that you know, normally comes to mind before. So yeah, those are the kind of things. Yeah, people are kind of disconnected to the hyper reality in of marketing and whatnot. They're more connected to themselves, to the family, and start to think of what is important. And also, again, local goods is, given the logistical problem, is more appreciated. Value for money goods is more appreciated. So these are the kind of things that I've seen moving forward.
Okay, thank you. It's just what you just said is actually, for me, it reminds me of we consume, therefore we exist. Right. So anyway, let me just go to the next question. Actually, I know that Bukalapak has been working closely with the bank. It's obviously it's not only for the payment, because in e-commerce, as you know, payment is important. But then if other than only because of that, and if there's any other reasons, why is that? Why you work with the banks, and how is it going to benefit the whole entire value chain?
Yeah. So we look at banks, of course, originally for payments, but there are many other things. Like the moment you start working in commerce, right, as a commerce platform, we start seeing, and you know, we our business is an intermediary, basically. So we are trying to connect supplies and demands, producers and needs and whatnot, right? So what we've seen, for example, that as the merchants grow their business, they need capital. So ability to connect these good businesses that is credit worthy, we can help the banks to provide the capital for them. So, you know, this is something that, you know, we have a product for that. So we ask you know, we talk to the banks and say like, hey, you know, what kind of guys that typically you want to fund? And we look at our merchants and say like, okay, you know, these are the type of people that we have. And if you need capital, you are whitelisted basically, and then you can apply and we connect you. Again, these are the kind of things that typically the small and medium enterprises feel they either have no time or they don't know how to do. So we try to make it easy for them. The other one that we are working with currently with some of the banks is especially now with Mandiri is this branchless banking or remittance. So in Indonesia, you know, typically if you want to send money, then you need to go to the bank or maybe postal office and whatnot. So what we do is we have all this network of mom and pop kiosk, and then we work with the bank to provide the license and the kind of like some of the their technology as well, and we connect them. So right now we work with the bank to convert, maybe not to convert, to add more capabilities. So now this warung can accept money, then they can do remittance. Now, the beauty of it is that at the moment, if you take a look at the number of outlets of all the banks in Indonesia, I think the number is about 37,000 or like say 40,000. And I believe our branches banking cooperation, the warungs, that is already more than that. So I think with this, then we can provide kind of like, again, financial inclusion for the people. Yeah, and once we start to connect this banking ecosystem, which is, you know, it's quite interesting, because I used to be a banker before, and I see a lot of different mindset with the bankers and the technology, right? In banking, what you do is guilty until proven innocent. So if you want to borrow money from a bank, they will ask you for a lot of things, and until you can convince them, then you deserve to get money. And in technology, it's the other way around. You are innocent first until you prove that you are a bad actor or you are guilty, then we'll give you punishment. And more and more, if we can combine this, a lot of our merchants, which is before it was thought of unbankable or, you know, kind of in the informal sector of the economy, if once they are eligible for all the service, then they become bankable, then they become kind of like a formal part of the economy. And that is what is the key reason for us that we want to work with banks.
Okay, thank you. So actually, this one is a loss of market share, starts with unhappy customers. So how does Bukalapak generate new ideas to satisfy customers and create new business opportunities? As you know, customer centricity is everything.
Yeah. This is actually, this is something that we keep thinking every day. But in short, like if you think about us as a marketplace platform, there are so many things that we do. Yeah, so many things that we can do, because it's very big scope of matching, say, products and needs and all these kind of things. Yeah. So what we are trying to do, first of all, is that, you know, is there any more unmet needs? And those are the new business opportunities. And we start to prioritize which ones are critical. And then afterwards, at the same time, having this platform that have to deal with a lot of transactions, and this is a very fast growing entity, fast growing business. Sometimes we don't do things right the first time as well. There is a lot of things that, let's say, we can always improve, right? You can always improve, and sometimes this unhappy customers is a very good source for us to know, like, okay, this is something that we need to do better, and yeah, we'll try very hard to fix this problem, because if you are a marketplace, reputation is very important. You know, there are many ways to get customers, but you know, sometimes you give a lot of promotions, you know, and so all of the relationship become transactional only. But what we also want to do is that once they come and do transactions, they find the experience in Bukalapak to be pleasant, to be delightful. They can make all these things. And if they're not, you know, our first order of business is try to find out and try to fix those issues.
Okay. Actually, this question is also from the live chat. The company leadership is always a hot topic. So what do you want to see in Bukalapak workers or teams? And do you feel like you're unlocking the full potential of all employees?
Yeah, well, that was like, if we can unlock the full potential of all employees, that is the holy grail of all the people. Yeah. Basically, Bukalapak started with a very strong purpose, which is just now we want to help create a fair economy for all, and our focus is always SMEs, yeah, because of, you know, it started with the dream or the meaning to make sure that everyone can benefit from commerce using our technology. So first of all, what I would like to see from my colleagues in Bukalapak is that drive to be able to bring, to help out, yeah, to believe in this mission, to believe in this purpose, because this is a very challenging mission and it's very tough. So what we'd like to see is like people who work from the heart, and they really want to not only, of course, develop themselves, make a good living, working with technology and all those kind of things, but they also want to see that the work that we do is benefiting our customers, the small medium enterprises, the mass market, and also, of course, the society at large. So and then we also have a few values that we put, and hopefully this is kind of like highlighted the kind of people that we want. First, we said the value is enable customers to grow. So whatever we want to do is have to have some enablement components and enable them to also grow. So not only static, but also have to grow. Sorry for this. This is a little bit direct, yeah. Give a damn. Give a damn meaning that you are accountable. You care about what you do. You deliver something that you'll be proud of. And you also see a lot of these things not only for yourself, but also for the people surrounding you, your colleagues, your society. The third one is, in Indonesian, we call it jangan baper lihat data, or basically this is a colloquial thing, meaning don't bring your feeling, but look at the data, or like always make informed decisions based on data. We are a technology company. We are doing a lot of transactions. We are basically we have a lot of data that we are working on, and of course we have our intuition or judgment as a start, and then after that you have to always test it, and only with that with putting the rigor, the science, then we can move forward better. Keep it simple. We want what we do to be, you know, we realize that we are working, we are intermediary company. We don't have a like real product. Typically the intermediary company have relatively smaller margin, and we also dealing with people who probably less sophisticated as a start. So we need to make our behavior to be efficient, to be simple. We have to make our product also easy, simple to use, and all those kind of stuff. The fifth one is also in Indonesian, gotong royong, which means working together and kind of like growing together. So typically we use this word when, you know, in the olden days when people want to do something together, like, you know, build roads, build bridges, they do a gotong royong session where everybody will come. And you know, I think the idea is we want to help each other. And this is also very Indonesian word. Our first president, Soekarno, when he was asked what is the fundamental principle of Indonesia, he come up with the 5 core value. And when he said, what is, if you can put it into one, and the one word, the one is gotong royong. And the last one is, we say be fun. You know, we work very hard. We deal with a lot of problems, and we have to think of this as that we shouldn't take ourselves too seriously personally, but of course our work very serious, but ourselves, we have to be able to enjoy that. And you know, we have to be pleasant, be fun. Those are the kind of things that we want to see in Bukalapak.
Okay, so how do you think the e-commerce will increase the productivity of societies and countries in unexpected ways in the short and long terms, in your opinion?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a strong believer in maybe commercial activities or commerce. Yeah, basically, if you look at the from the beginning of history, people who are, you know, they start with self-sufficiency, and once they have access, then they start trading or conducting commerce. And the more the wider the commerce network, you know, the more productive they are, the higher their civilization. And I think with e-commerce, basically it creates the bridge for all the, you know, basically breaks down all the boundaries. You can, all the information flows, all the goods that is everywhere, and all the potential buyer that is everywhere can be connected to technology. So again, I don't know whether this is unexpected, but I think just the ability to have all this access will bring a lot of value, and our job is to break down those barriers. You know, of course, information now can flow quite freely, but the logistics, the payments, the payment, and the trust is something that still need to be built, and it is our job to do that. Like, you know, for example, before COVID, you can say a lot of transaction in e-commerce only happen on a few things. Maybe a lot of people sell a lot of things, but the top ones is always very standardized goods like electronics. Typically, electronics is number one, because, you know, if you buy like a smartphone, you know what you're getting, and it's lend itself to things that can move quickly, but relatively lack of trust because you put your trust on the brand of the goods that you purchase. But now because of COVID, people start buying groceries. People start buying more clothes. Typically the goods that typically people want to touch first, or like food, you know, all that kind of stuff. They start doing it in e-commerce. So I'm hoping moving forward with the technology, we can break all these boundaries, and as a result, we can be more productive.
Okay, thank you for all the answers. Let's go to the live chat questions. There are a few questions actually from live chat. I think one of them, there are so many actually, but let's just go from one by one. So this one is about what is the future of e-commerce? Where do you see it is heading to?
Wow. that is a very interesting question. In my mind, we human being live in a physical world, and we are social animal, and I believe there is always benefit for people to you know, they want to go out, meet, you know, touch, something like that. I think it's always going to be there. However, maybe if I speak about this 6 months ago or like last year, we can say that e-commerce will be maybe as important or more important than physical transactions, and maybe people will feel like doubtful. But now that COVID happens, when it becomes viable or maybe the only viable method to do transactions, then I think people will be more poignant now. This point is that, okay. So I think in the end of the day, e-commerce will be something, I think the future will be omni-channel in terms of transactions. I wouldn't probably say that everything will be done through e-commerce, but it will be will play a lot more important role, and I don't see why it has to be dominated one way or the other. I think it's complementary to the physical world, and I think there are things that is good to be done in e-commerce, and also there's a few things that's probably can be done through offline channel. So maybe in offline, we can focus on delivering only the experience, like, you know, people come and touch and smell and all those kind of stuff. But that we're using e-commerce, the ability to, you know, to serve better, to do fulfillment, using more data, more efficiently. You know that you don't have to store all your goods in a physical one physical location. You can spread it and you can send it later on and whatnot. I think that will be something that I envision moving forward. And then I guess for us, we want to be part of that, and we are trying to improve our ability more and more.
Okay, so Dr. Rakumat, maybe you can give a very practical advice to this question. So if they are the new business in e-commerce, as you know, they are not famous, they are not well known. So how can we build the trust for visitors to check that out?
Yeah, I think a couple of things. Yeah, first, basically, like, you know, you there is a few things. So first is you need to make the house looks in order as well. So there's two components. One is to bring people to come to you, and then once they come, they get good experience. On the people who to get people to come to you, there's multiple ways. It's also like in the physical world, you can do promotion. You know, there's a way to sponsor your shop into the higher level, for example, so more conspicuous. It's like in the video, like YouTube, or sometimes you can put your video up top as well. So that's one way to do that. sometimes people do through like, you know, like pricing, make it very cheap and whatnot. That's also quite conspicuous. But the idea is always, once they go there and they look into it, the shop has to be, have to look professional, you know, the pictures, the description. And then also once people ask question, quickly we answer in a nice manner. Those are the kind of things that we've seen, because you know, sometimes we will say like, oh, price is the one thing. Actually, price is only one component out of a few. People like want to see, you know, they want to buy goods that is well described, that look interesting, and then, you know, when they deal with the people, its response is quick as well. And once you start having one happy customer and two and three, and you'll start building your own reputation. So yeah, that is my thoughts.
Okay, just a couple of questions and then we can close the session. There's one more question. You just mentioned a few things that before when you talk about the leadership and the what you want to see in your team in the company. So Mr. Malok asked this question. Of those that Buck has mentioned, just to mention, so what are the three most effective productivity tools to articulate in these challenging times of pandemic?
Yeah. So basically, in this pandemic, I think one of the things that, and I also, I'm still learning as well on this, yeah, but my experience during this pandemic, the first thing that we have to solve or address before we go to do everything else is that we have to realize our team is human being who's probably worried or afraid. And that is something that, you know, it creates a lot of uncertainty. So this is something that when we start, we want to address first that, hey, hi guys, we realize that this is important time, very, very challenging time, and we want you all to be safe. So what we try to do is, okay, let's try to, let's say, work from home and have a mindset that, like, you know, once you're worried or panicking, our system or our brain will basically shut down and only focus on either fight or flight, you know. And this is not something that you can fight, you know, because you don't know. So a lot of people may be worried. So what we also need to clarify is to put a mindset of, hey, focus on the things that you can control, and yeah, basically let go on the things that you cannot. For example, no point of being angry about COVID. So COVID is there, it's a fact of life. What you can do is to take care of your life, take care of yourself. We'll help you with the tool of so that you can work from home, but you also need to make sure that you don't get infected. Stay at home, eat healthy, blah blah blah. Keep reminding them that. Providing with that circle of safety, that you know, update about how we are doing, both good and bad, because what I realized that uncertainty during in the uncertain times, people assume the worst, and every single things that they do, they translate it into something, you know, the most catastrophic scenario. So sometimes, which is quite normal if you're panicking. So we try to lower their cortisol level probably. So we'll do a lot of fun things as well as communication. Like, you know, we communicate very regularly, and we try to update them on the things like, okay, this is what we are doing because of this. This is what we are doing because of this. And then with all that happen, then we can have some sort of sense of normalcy. So people then, you know, you can say like, okay, try to build some habit, check in, check out, from time to time, do a video conference call, not only texting, and giving back this sense of connectedness to the people, it is quite important. So those are what the things that I think works for my organization so far.
Oh, I'm sorry that my microphone was muted. Okay, so there is a last one question from live chat. And with that highly competitive situation in the marketplace, so how can an SME get the attention if they don't have much budget to promote so that their product can be seen in top rank of the search? I think it's a very practical question.
Yeah, basically, there's a few things. Yeah, of course, the one critical thing is that you either you want to be noted, then you have to be unique, right? Of course, if you're selling all the same goods, then you probably need that promotion, because let's say you open a shop that sell something that like thousands of other people selling the same thing, then you cannot be noticed. So the idea is that for small and medium business, try to find unique products that is needed, and that is probably the most critical part, because in the end of the day, when once people search something, then of course this promotion is part of that, but also the ability to, you know, if you're selling that a product that is looked after, looked into by the customers, then your product will pop up also. Regular thing. And then I think for us, and then once yours is on top, there's a few other things that you can do, like, you know, again, as I mentioned, make the picture looks nice, put like description to be well written and also descriptive. Those are will help, because sometimes you see people just put some not so good pictures or the description, they just copy paste from everything from somewhere. It's not that clear, and they sell like very generic products, and that is a key to mediocrity. So I think you should, people who want to be successful have to put more thoughts into this, and even without that as much budget, you can stand out in the marketplace.
Okay, so thank you very much for such a long time. Then it's already 1 hour past. So let me just ask you to make a closing remark if you have any message for the viewers.
Yeah, maybe I would like to thank you for attending the sessions, and hope that there are some things that we said that could be helpful. And again, apologize if, you know, we say something wrong and whatnot. And again, for us, this is very challenging time for everyone. And but what I can say is, what we believe that this will pass also. This too shall pass, as I always say it with this. And hopefully, as long as we keep very strong spirit, as long as we are still alive and want to try more, we will walk out of this situation more stronger, better, and more productive. And I wish every one of you good health. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your time. And viewers, thank you for joining us today. I really appreciate your time. And if you have any other questions, you can put the questions in the comment section after the live chat finished. And if you don't subscribe to our channel yet, then you know that you are going to miss out on a lot. So please don't forget to subscribe to the channel. And Pak Rakhmat, also don't forget to subscribe to our channel also. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, we look forward to it. So thank you very much for all the sessions and all the questions. And I know that time is already passed, so let me close the session. And viewers, we will prepare a lot more insightful, and also the experts actually will be waiting in the list. So please stay tuned and please watch us again. Thank you. Have a nice day. Thank you. Yeah.